Coming up next on Arizona Horizon, we'll hear about Google's self-driving cars now being tested in Chandler. Also tonight, authoritarianism and the candidacy of Donald Trump. Those stories next on Arizona Horizon.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Leaders of the State House announced today that they will allow reporters to cover proceedings from the House floor without undergoing background checks. Last week, Speaker of the House David Gowan announced that criminal and other background screening would be required for reporters who wanted access to the House floor. Gowan cited security concerns, but the new policy specifically targeted a reporter from the Arizona Capital Times who wrote articles that exposed Gowan's improper use of state resources. Starting today, the background checks are out. Democratic State Representative Mark Cardenas reacted to the reversal.
It's Speaker Gowan admitting his mistake, realizing that it's not about security, it's about a vendetta against the press, specifically one reporter that has been reporting him in an unflattering light. It's time to be the bigger person and finish off session instead of trying to go fight for reporters and personal vendettas and retributions on people that are doing their job.
Arizona would have been the only state in the country to require Capitol reporters to undergo criminal background checks. And water started flowing in a Tempe Town lake again today. This after the lake was emptied in February to allow completion of a new dam system. Tempe officials say it could take weeks to fill the lake, which can hold now 900 million gallons of water. That's 100 million gallons more than the old dam. Water activities on the lake are expected to resume by the end of the month. Tonight's edition of Arizona Technology and Innovation looks at how Chandler has become Arizona's first city to test Google self-driving cars. Here now with more is Chandler Mayor Jay Tibshraeny, and also joining us is Micah Miranda, Chandler's Director of Economic Development. Good to have you both here. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having us.
Self-driving cars, what is going on out here?
Well, Chandler's continuing to be an innovation and technology hub of the Southwest, but Google has this test program. They're testing this vehicle in Kirkland, Washington, in a suburb of San Jose, California, Austin, Texas, and they said, we're going to try it in Arizona.
Why Arizona? What's the reasoning?
I'm not sure. I mean, there's a lot of technology-affiliated things that are happening in Arizona, in the Valley in specific. I think the weather thing, maybe they wanted to see how that worked with their technology. So they came out, they talked to a bunch of us mayors, I think four or five, and they picked Chandler to be the first city that will be involved with their testing program.
Let's find out about this. How will the testing be done?
The testing will be done through drivers. First of all, Google's going to deploy their vehicles onto Chandler streets, and they're going to drive Chandler streets and map it out. Part of Google's technology requires robust understanding of what the infrastructure looks like, and so that's what they're starting with, is mapping the infrastructure.
And these drivers will be from Google, from the city, a little bit of both?
These drivers will all be Google employees, and they will be behind the wheel of four Lexus SUVs.
Now, once they get away from the wheel, will they still be in the car in case the self-driving car gets a mind of its own? And
yes, they will. They'll still be in the car. They will be there after full testing and mapping is complete to intervene should it be needed.
Yes. And as far as the roads that will be used, outlying roads, city streets, freeways?
All of the above.
Really?
Yes. Yes.
It's for when the driver is behind the wheel and for when the driver is next to the wheel?
They will be behind the wheel all the time.
Oh, okay. They're hands off.
Yep.
Unless something, and I mean, it sounds to me, doing research into this, there haven't been many self-driving car accidents or mishaps, have there?
No, they're not. And most accidents out there are human-driven, 94%, and that's why the self-driving car. But there really hasn't. I think there was one fender bender in San Francisco. But the technology is so unique that it's going to be very successful. And they won't be reading the newspaper or on their phone texting while they're driving because it's driverless.
Yeah.
But it's safe now. It's testing right now. Because people say, Jay, what's going to happen if there's a problem? That's why you have the person in the car in case there's a problem. But they'll be on all our streets, all over the highway, the residential streets. They're ready. We've seen the videos of the technology. It's pretty spectacular.
Well, we have video right now of the vehicles because I was curious as to what they look like, and we found Google sent us a little example here. And these just—it basically looks like a regular vehicle with a hat.
It's a Lexus or it's an SUV of some sort,
yeah.
But with lasers and different type of technology and cameras. So it's a regular looking vehicle, except it says Google on. You'll know that the Google vehicle's out there. They're in town right now mapping as we speak.
And when you say mapping now, there are lasers and other things that depend on those maps, correct?
Correct. Part of the technology as we understand it from Google is they will have, like the mayor said, radar. They will have GPS. They will have laser sensors that track its position relative to other things in their environment. So the technology they have allows 360-degree views to be processed by the computer software, so they really understand where they're at.
Yeah, and it sounds like it's GPS on steroids here. This is a lot more accurate than GPS.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Now, as far as Chandler is concerned, why is this good for the city? Why was this a good thing?
This further cements our reputation for technology. I mean, we obviously have Intel, but General Motors located one of their four only innovation hubs in Chandler. And so they have one in Austin, Texas, too, which coincidentally is also doing the Google project in Austin, Texas. So we have a lot of technology-based companies and industries, and I think they looked and said, Chandler's a natural fit to try this next generation of technology. And that's what this is. You know, in about 10 years from now, who knows how this is going to play out. But already General Motors, Mercedes-Benz are experimenting with these vehicles. Google themselves have driven these driverless vehicles in their test city so far over 1.5 million miles.
And I just looked at my notes here, and 16 times these vehicles have been hit by other cars. Really only one accident, it seems as though, that the Google car could possibly be. I mean, the concept of accidents may be a foreign concept in coming years, correct?
That's what they're working towards. Obviously, we suffer from traffic accidents, and that's part of Google's initiative here is to cut down on the number of traffic deaths while also being able to provide transportation mobility to those that may not have it due to disabilities.
Now, will they be driving, again, it sounds like they'll be driving maybe with a little extra caution, maybe a little extra courtesy, something we're not really used to here on Arizona streets, but I mean, will that disrupt the flow of traffic, do you think?
You know, part of the technology that they have deployed is to mimic human driving. So some of the things that we take for granted is driving on regular streets is, you know, inching forward to make right-hand turns. Through their testing and history, they've discovered that this causes anxiety on roadways. So they're teaching the vehicles to be smarter, to act more like a driver while at the same time maintaining all the safety necessary.
Well, I mean, I think one of the reasons why people inch forward at red lights, they don't want to turn right, they want to see.
Exactly.
They don't need to see now.
Exactly.
The car sees. This is,
yes.
Okay, a boon for Chandler.
Yes.
What does it translate to jobs? What can you see out there?
I don't know if this particular project translates to job, but the marketing and the exposure it gives Chandler worldwide, being one of these test cities, is really immeasurable. And we'll utilize it in our marketing efforts as we go out and try to attract industry. We're dealing with high-tech companies and industry every day. And so this just helps cement our reputation. And it kind of, it's a synergy. The more, the merrier. And the more that come, you get more behind them. So we look at Google just kind of naturally fitting into our efforts to attracting industry and to further cementing Chandler being innovation and technology hub of the Southwest. And that's why when we go up against Austin, Texas, we know we're in pretty good company because that's who we compete against a lot for the jobs. So we have Google today, but the jobs will follow tomorrow.
And as far as the testing, when did it start?
Testing started about last week.
Okay, and how long will it go?
It'll go for an indefinite period of time until they fully understand how the sensors react in our desert environment.
I was going to say, wouldn't you want this thing to be rolling around the streets late June when it's 120 degrees?
Absolutely.
And also maybe in late July when you got dust storms. I mean, do they know how they work in dust storms?
That's what they're here to find out.
Yeah. All right, so last question. You mentioned Technology Hub, and we've had you on the show many times,
yes.
And you're very proud of the technology.
Yes.
So how are things going?
They're going really good. Chandler continues to lead the way in attracting jobs and attracting industry, and so we'll continue on those efforts. We work really hard at it, and I think we've created a good environment in Chandler for companies to locate. And the whole valley really is very dynamic right now. We just need to kind of stay the course, and I think the opportunities will continue to come our way. We are going to have a community forum on this particular car with a sample car there, hopefully, so that'll be open to the public and the media. We'll have to arrange that date once Google is comfortable with having it to announce, okay, we're proceeding on the next phase of this.
All right, but until then, if you see a car with a hat, just don't worry.
Don't worry.
It's taking care of itself just fine, even if there's no one behind. There will be someone behind the wheel, because
yes,
that's probably a little alarming if you're driving by and seeing
yes.
no one behind yep. the wheel.
There will be somebody behind the wheel.
Even if they're going like this, keeping their both hands up.
Exactly.
Okay, good to have you both here. Thanks
Thank
for joining
you.
Us.
Thank you for having us.
Authoritarian style of leadership is characterized by a strong leader with a simple message of security and the promise to defeat real or imagined threats with force. Some political observers see those qualities as the main attraction of Donald Trump's presidential campaign. Here to discuss that idea is Kim Fridkin, a professor at ASU's School of Global and Political, it's politics and global studies,
That's
correct?
It.
All right, it's a couple of those things in there to say. Give me a better definition of authoritarianism.
Well, that's when certain types of people really want to maintain social order, and they don't like change, and they want a strong leader to try to maintain that social order.
And not only to maintain the order, but pretty much in general to protect them, right?
Right. Well, that authoritarianism becomes more activated when people feel threatened. So that's where the protection comes from. So they look to a leader who will protect them by maintaining the life as they know it, how they want it. They're afraid of new disruptions to what they know.
And there are people that are kind of naturally that way, but almost anyone can be that way if faced with a threat, correct?
Yes, I think some people are more likely to become that way when they feel threatened by some kind of outside force. But other people don't really have that tendency, and even if there's a threat, they will not become authoritarian.
So who is most attracted to authoritarianism?
I think it's people who are more likely to like things to stay the same, not to change. So they're people who feel threatened by a new order. So let's say like changes in the country, like new immigrants coming to the country, or changes like social changes that have been occurring, such as gay marriage, people who feel that is threatening their way of life.
And I reading on this, it sounds like men, more often than not,
yes.
Less educated, economically marginalized in many cases. Sounds like that might be a pretty big constituency.
yes, it can be. But it's only some people within those demographics. And I think that the economic marginalization, that's probably really important, because they feel that they need to make sure that they're not going to lose their position in society, so they're more afraid of change.
But that's interesting, because we keep hearing how so many people have lost their position in society. And there's really, I mean, you would think that they would be saying, all right, let's change things up. Let me try another chance from this direction as opposed to that direction. But it sounds like they're hunkering down.
In terms of, but certain people, like, so we're there's more discussion about Trump in terms of marginalized people economically. But Sanders is appealing to a different demographic, but also people who feel marginalized maybe in a different way. So he's not appealing to people in terms of this authoritarianism, but it's still the same sort of marginalized, I mean, different type of people, but
that's interesting. I noticed that the education gap was also a big factor here. Talk to us about that.
Yeah, so I think that people who are less educated are more likely to be attracted to a leader who has more authoritarian tendencies because the message that resonates with them is a simpler message. So one of maybe more like slogans and things to make them feel safe, but doesn't really require much cognitive processing.
But yeah, it looks like it does cross some educational lines. It seems like it crosses income, it crosses age, it crosses religion. I mean, Trump has tapped into something here. I don't know if he did it purposely or not, but he's tapped into something here. Is this something that will be a factor for quite a while?
I think it will be. Part of the reason is right now the way our politics is, there's a correlation between people who feel threatened by outsiders or others, and that corresponds right now with the ideology. So, for example, it hasn't always been this way, but things like gay rights or transgender issues and immigration and letting Syrian refugees come in, those tend to be people on the left are fine with that, and people on the right are less likely to support that. So there's this co-variation between ideology and what authoritarian personalities would be comfortable with.
Interesting. Okay, so it looks as well as it's a backlash against social change, pretty much, is what you were talking about. Is it also a backlash against younger people, a backlash against the better educated middle class people? I mean, because they see those folks as not holding on to the same ideals?
Yeah, I think it's more of a backlash against social change, what sometimes is referred to as the other, so things that they're not, that people are not comfortable with, that are different, that seem to be changing the way of life that that they grew up with, that they're comfortable with. So it's not really a backlash against like a more educated society, I don't think.
At least not a conscious backlash against that.
Right.
It seems like it also it kind of falls under this umbrella of political correctness. We hear people using this phrase a lot, and it seems as though when you're talking about diversity and gender roles and gay marriage and secular values and all these things, there's always a measure of quote-unquote political correctness involved in the dialogue. Is that a sign of authoritarianism in the conversation?
I think it's a symbol that people can relate to, and so that's what is kind of drawing people is they don't like this political correctness, which symbolizes a lot of these other things that we're talking about. Mm-hmm. So it kind of is a cue for them to think about issues in a certain way.
And I would imagine they're concerned with a long-term generational shift here. They might be older, but they still see something in the future that they don't like, and they're kind of inching over toward that idea.
Mm-hmm. I think that's right. And I think that Trump has tapped into it. And I think that whether it's on purpose or not, these people are attracted to his really, simple message about we don't want this kind of change. I'm going to make the country great again, before these things change.
Right, indeed, again before. Okay, so authoritarianism, is it behind much of the polarization we're seeing now in politics?
No, I think it's different, but I think that what happens is that we're having this polarization, and the polarization is not only on economic issues, it's on social issues. And so the polarization on the social issues is making the right farther, more homogeneous, I guess.
Right. Okay.
And so that's kind of encouraging this authoritarianism.
Okay. Well, with that in mind, is authoritarianism behind the rift in the Republican Party?
Well, that's a good question. I think that the more extreme candidates, like Trump and Cruz, the non-traditional candidates, I think they're appealing more towards this authoritarianism than the more traditional Republicans. So I don't know, which is causing which, but there is definitely a correlation.
And we should mention, this is not just America here. We're seeing a lot of this throughout the West, aren't we?
Yes, and I think it's because of the rise of the threat of terrorism makes people scared, and that's when people are more susceptible to these attitudes.
Yeah, to the fear and the concern over the other, as you mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it's very interesting stuff. I mean, it's kind of like a political lesson writ large, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It's very interesting. It's very... It's a little scary, right? Because people are kind of latching on to certain symbols and not really thinking through what these symbols mean, I think.
All right. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Introducing Classical Arizona PBS, your classical music connection. On TV, listen to Classical Arizona PBS on digital channel 8.4. On the go, download the free Classical Arizona PBS app to stream performances. Find out about classical concerts and watch exclusive videos. Download the free Classical Arizona PBS app, then follow Classical Arizona PBS on Facebook and Twitter for news, photos, and events near you. Classical Arizona PBS, your classical music connection.
Corporations pay big money to see their names on the sides of stadiums and arenas, but in high school sports, the naming of a field is a much more humble and meaningful story. Producer Shauna Fisher and photographer Langston Fields introduce us to a Phoenix author answering the question, who is Jim?
Yeah. There were...
By day, Scott Hansen runs a successful public relations company. But during high school football season, he trades in his suits for stripes as a head referee. And it was at one of those games that Hansen found his newest venture.
I've been officiating high school sports in Arizona for 30 years. And 3 years ago, my football crew and I arrived at a high school, and I looked up at the stadium and saw the name of the stadium. It was at Cactus High School, and it was M.L. Huber Stadium. And I asked the guy in the parking lot, I said, hey, who is M.L. Huber? And he didn't know. The next week, our crew arrived at another high school, Independence High School, to officiate the varsity football game on Friday night, and it says Tolmachov Stadium on the side of the building. And I asked the guy in the parking lot, hey, who is that? Who'd they name this after? And he didn't know.
Hansen loves history and a challenge, so he decided to do a little research and find out the who and why high school football fields and gymnasiums are named for. What emerged after 3 long years is the book, Who is Jim?
Really what's happened is all of these facilities in Arizona, many of them were named for people a long, long time ago, and it's become sort of lost Arizona history.
Hansen's quest has taken him all over Arizona, from Parker to Thatcher and from Flagstaff to Nogales. In Bisbee, he found the answer to Warren Field.
George Warren was an old prospector back in the 1800s, and George discovered what is now the Copper Queen Mine. Well, George passed away before he had a chance to really make any money from that mining operation, but the people that were around him knew him enough that they named that ballpark Warren Ballpark. But there's a little more about George Warren. Think about the seal of the state of Arizona, and there's a prospector holding a shovel. That's George Warren.
There are fields dedicated to military personnel. McClintock High in Tempe is named after a member of Teddy Roosevelt's Rough Riders, James McClintock. McClintock was also in the first graduating class of what is now known as Arizona State University.
Well, in Winslow, Arizona, they have the J. Vargas baseball field. Well, J. Vargas was a Vietnam War hero, received a Medal of Honor for his heroism while he was in Vietnam. That's so important to not only Winslow, but to Arizona and the United States in general, that we just can't forget some of those stories that are really a part of what makes Arizona such a great place.
Hansen met many challenges along the way.
Much of it had to do with the people at the schools today don't know the history of their own schools.
And discovered that sometimes the most obvious answer is the wrong one.
I grew up right here in Phoenix, and I always thought Greenway High School was named Greenway High School because it's on Greenway Road. But come to find out in my research, Isabella Greenway was the first female congressional representative from Arizona. And her husband, John, was a copper executive who founded Ajo, Arizona.
But when it came to his own alma mater, Washington High School, that perhaps was the easiest one of all. The field is named for Coach Tom Pagel. Hansen played ball for Coach Pagel. In all, Who is Jim highlights 200 fields and gymnasiums. And despite the varied stories, Hansen says the honorees have one common thread.
I think what I really found in doing the research is that the people who are included in the book are or were the fabric of their community. They had such an influence on the student athletes that they coached, the kids that they taught, the community at large, whichever small town or large town that they lived in. They were so important to that particular area that we have memorialized them forever with the names of schools and gyms and those types of things.
And that is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thanks for joining us. You have a great evening.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.